I start, I'd like to thank the organizing committee and Mr. Chairman for introducing me. It is a pleasure to be here with you, and I have to admit that what you guys are doing in here in the center of Europe, it's really unique, because I think Daniel already mentioned that a lot of people in a lot of other countries, a lot of other medical faculties could actually envy you for what you are doing, and it's really important that you continue. So before I start my talk, I'd like to ask you to think of that. Somebody said quite a few decades ago that half of the stuff that we teach our students is going to be completely wrong or, you know, not important in 10 years' time. And the trouble is, we as medical teachers of our students, we don't know which of these half of the wrong things is the actual half that's going to be outdated. So we don't actually know to tell this, our students this fact. And also, before I start, I'd like to push emphasis on this, what people say, the five dimensions that optimize what medical doctors do at their professional life. And they emphasize the empirical evidence, the experiential evidence, the rationality that they have to include before they decide, the patient values and the preferences, professionalism, and the system features that they are going to examine, etc., together with other important features like societal and legal issues, etc., etc. So with these thoughts, I would like to tell you that I'm going to talk about the role of big data and learning analytics in medical education. I'm Panos Bamidis. I come from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, the medical school, and I'm going to share with you some thoughts about how we actually envisage the things that you are doing in here, and the things we are doing in Greece, and the things everybody is doing in their own countries and their own networks. How are they going to be shaped up in the next few years to come? So I'll briefly summarize a few taboos and trends in medical education, and then shift into the big data and learning analytics, tell you what the important things are so far, and how we envisage new developments, share with you some thoughts and things we have already done in the problem-based learning and virtual patients, plus some infrastructure that we are setting for game-based learning and experiential learning. So medicine is a conservative discipline. It's a bad reputation. But this is not due to the disciplinary content that we have. This has always been at the forefront of scientific innovation, per se. But it's due to how learning and teaching is supported via the policies we have and the educational practices that we shape. And this is because, for example, we use big amphitheaters for lectures. I mean, my first year lecture was attended by 400 students, and they continue to be 400 for the first few weeks, to be dropped to almost half near the Christmas time. And this is usual in courses in the first few years, but in the last few years, amphitheaters have got only 5 or 10 students out of these 400. We also have end of semester exams, always in a piece of paper, sometimes nowadays in a computer, but always in the same method of summative assessment. Also, we have a bad hierarchical model of interacting with each other. I mean, peers and learners don't interact too much. When my students are going into the clinical parts of their curriculum, they only interact with a few experts and only for a few minutes a day, and then they are left in their own sake, going around the clinics and departments and telling jokes to one another, or looking at what others are doing, but without anybody bothering with them. And there is also a lack of linking with patient communities or other communities of learners, for example, so that we get important interaction with them. And there is also some things that we don't do formally in the curriculum. There is a formal curriculum that we have, but in addition to that, we expect students to assimilate, evaluate, and use new information, because this is what is done by health professionals, by experts. And they have to learn to communicate clinically and find out what these clinical and communication skills they need to attain are, and also develop proper attitudes. But we never teach them, especially in traditional curriculums and old traditional curriculums, we don't teach them proper attitudes, professionalism, for example, and the professionalism of the new ages. A couple of weeks ago, I was teaching a lecture on the medical education course, which is an elective course that I run. And when I asked my students to look at the video that I had uploaded on the site about professionalism, one of the students said, okay, yes, they're going to tell us how to wear ties and things like this, but this is not about professionalism in our ages anymore. I said, you'll be surprised, but he talks about social media and professionalism in there as well. So he went and watched it at the end, because I told him that is also new stuff about professionalism and also about emerging technologies. Sometimes we don't teach our students how to use these technologies, but we are expecting them somehow to find out how to use them and benefit from these technologies. So, but apart from all these taboos, medicine is the most appropriate testbed for alternative educational experience as well. It can also, all these alternative experiences can be supported by learning technologies, and it can be influenced by two recent thrusts in medical education. The first one is a move towards student-centered learning, and the second is a call for stronger links between teaching and disciplinary research, findings of research to be fused with teaching per se. Clinical experience is fundamental in medical education, so all these should be enriching the learning environments and to be sort of more emphasized towards scenario-based learning or inquiry-based learning. That's why I will share with you a few examples later on about this. So contemporary medical education approaches do go along with this scenario-based learning, where you have a small group of students rather a bigger theater with 400, where you teach a scenario or a case and people interact with this fuzzy set at the beginning of the symptomatology or the history of the patient, and then they come to resolve this by using their knowledge or finding out what knowledge they need. We also need to follow what is called just-in-time learning. There's a lot of information, half of it is going to be outdated in a few years' time, and we so need to tell our students that they need to learn and they need to know how to find the information whenever they need it. This is what this just-in-time presents. Also, a lot of discussion has been going on around and is going to be more emphasized in the Horizon 2020, as Daniel mentioned, about personalized learning and early skills training. In my university, there was no early skills training some years ago. And back in 2005, we introduced this clinical skills laboratory in which students were actually getting their hands onto mannequins and doing some early training in the third year already, so that they know what to do when they go into the clinics and the hospitals. And we more and more believe that our students should be self-directed into some parts of training. So all of these do lead us to use more and more digital resources. And this is because the scenario-based learning is increasingly more and more digitized, more and more e-based. So all this interaction group is now done in front of a computer or in front of tablets and then in front of the internet, and with the use of the internet. And just-in-time learning is assisted a lot with mobile devices and iTabs and access to Wikipedia and other resources. Effective use of video and animations is a must nowadays. It's the previous speaker just emphasized that all these sentences that I'm presenting you might get boring, so I must use video and animation. And there is an increased emphasis on personalized learning, as I said, with self-directed learning and mobile learning. And this calls for a shift in the design of curricula that we have been following in the last centuries, perhaps in the last decades for Greece, which promotes personalized individual study in the medical curriculum. So let's shift into how medical education can be shaped by emerging technologies. Teaching and learning must be social and informal. Informal, as I said, because there is already a hidden curriculum and social, because we need to interact and get also values from other communities, like patients, for example, or other peers, etc. And learning technologies have shown that they can do that in the last few years. So in the last 7 to 8 years now, social media have been more and more introduced into medical education. They support and sustain communities of practice, they update our experiences, they bring us new information, new material, new forms of digital material. And the digital literacy we need for that needs to be updated as well. We need expertise in a range of tools to be able to grasp all this importance of the technologies. E-portfolios is also one of the learning technologies we need. We need tools to reflect, but also demonstrate that our students, or even ourselves, the educators, are competent enough. And this is perhaps missing from a lot of schools around the globe. And open educational resources, I think you know that. Daniel has shown you how sharing resources in medical education has been shaping the future of medical education, and you've been practicing this already more than I can tell you. So we have an academic institution which has got learning systems, learning management systems, or other repositories, and nowadays they use a lot of social media, Web 2.0, etc. And they use a lot of specialized educational resources and modules. And when you ask people to share these, usually what we do is that we search in individual repositories or search engines without any specific targeting, and we get a lot of unnecessary stuff. There are minimal mechanisms for sharing, and networks like Mefanet are good solutions towards this direction. There is minimal interoperability between systems when systems are not running the same software and there are needed different access points and different users to log in different systems. And there is not a lot of peer-to-peer collaboration nowadays that we sort of put it in the grounds of medical education. So we have this thing that a lot of institutions have got what they need, but they don't interact a lot with each other. They don't, when we ask them to have an inter-institution communication, this cannot always be effective. And there are not a lot of countries around the world that have got these medical faculties network that you guys have. So we need specialized distributed pools of autonomous and specialized educational modules. All this amazing stuff that you can create with different technologies and devices, you need also mechanisms that couple them. Mechanisms to search information, retrieve information, rate information, evaluate information, adapt it to your own needs, or in other words, repurpose this information and revise it so that it fits your own educational needs, your own educational context. And this is what you have been doing in the MEFANET, for example, as has been already shown. And this is what we also tried to do in a project we've had in the past 3 years, which is called MEDUCATOR. And we tried to do this integration of the materials around the institutions and the collaborations between the different peers with using two technologies. One technology was using was using Web 2.0 technologies or social media, and the other one is using Web 3.0, the semantic web. And I'll draw emphasis on this in the next few minutes. So we are trying to sort of have the institutions, even if they have different learning management systems or different setups in their own institutions, to be able to still search and collaborate with other institutions by using these frameworks that we have developed and tested extensively in the last 3 years. I'd like to share with you a video now on this project, just to break the even. Hope the sound will work.
Hi, I'm Carlos
importance of openness, social participation, collaboration, social networking, and crowd intelligence. Recent advances in Web 3.0, or else the semantic web front, have shed light and emphasis on the linked data, which basically concerns the publishing of structured information and data, so that these can be interlinked more effectively and hopefully become more useful altogether. Different platforms have been created and educated to enable this endeavor. In so doing, a pivotal role has been played by the educator ontology, which provides a consistent way of describing content across all educator platforms. By fusing the above two concepts together, we have managed to unite or else federate the different learning management systems and open educational repositories together. In order for educators and learners to be able to retrieve, organize, reuse, and share, basically, their educational resources.
Γνώρισα το πρόγραμμα Melina Plus στα πλαίσια του μαθήματος ιατρικής εκπαίδευσης. Ήταν κάτι πρωτόγνωρο και πάρα πολύ ενδιαφέρον, γιατί μπορούσαμε να μοιραζόμαστε με έναν τόσο απλό τρόπο εκπαιδευτικό υλικό.
Πρέπει εμείς οι εκπαιδευτές των φοιτητών της ιατρικής να συνειδητοποιήσουμε ότι ήρθε ο καιρός να αλλάξουμε όσον αφορά την εκπαίδευση και οπωσδήποτε να εισάγουμε τις νέες τεχνολογίες.
The pivotal role of this is the educator ontology, which is a metadata schema which unites the different platforms and instantiation together.
Medical education will be completely transformed in the next few years, and we believe an educator is a leader in this field.
Gets more enriched in all these platforms, discovery and retrieval gets complicated.
We managed to combine different technologies, social media, collaborative technologies, semantic web.
As a consequence, one needs advanced searching features so as to avoid content duplication and enable learners to effectively locate their content. Evaluation has been conducted in educators with different target groups. The best practice recommendations we elicit from educator work are going to shape the involved communities of practice in the future years.
I'm very excited with this experience and the innovative suggestions that the educator project offered to the healthcare community.
Πρώτους 35 εικονικούς ασθενείς, τους μοναδικούς, μέσα στα ελληνικά πανεπιστήμια, στις ιατρικές σχολές των ελληνικών πανεπιστήμιων.
Educator and EVIP have had a lot in common. They're the two biggest education projects in recent time, and both are interested in the development, exposure, and repurposing of educational content.
The Medicator has taken a very comprehensive approach to the problem of content sharing. It is, in fact, not only a technical problem, but it's also an organizational and institutional problem.
Its compliance with linked data design principles enable the high interoperability of the medical resources across various applications and systems.
Because after all, if we want to build content sharing solution, we really want to enable a community of people to share this content.
All lab outcomes are provided to users for free and to ensure the robustness of the service, multiple partners for redundant servers of each keynote.
The work that an educator has done in applying semantic web technologies to the discovery of medical education resources is truly leading the way for others in medical education.
The innovative program comes not only to exploit not only by our membership, the innovative consortium, but also by external individuals and organizations.
If it was an earlier project and has continued to successfully implement its outputs and resources long after the end of the project, and so we now believe that Medicator will go on to do exactly the same.
It started that the user base of Medicator will be steadily increasing, and hopefully within 5 years this could reach up to 10,000 users.
Through the application of semantic web technology with standardized metadata schemas, it will aid the discovery of medical education resources throughout the world.
I'm happy to say that Medicator has submitted a proposal to develop the Medicator metadata schema as an ubiquitous ANSI standard.
We are happy with the feedback we received. The future looks bright.
Great things are coming.
Having finished with this as a project, then we were sort of believed that we had done some good job in using what is called the linked open data and being one of the first projects to capitalize on the technological developments of linked open data, especially in medical education, but generally in education. And the Commission, the European Commission, suddenly switched into another term, which is called big open data rather than linked open data, and a lot of other players from other disciplines are now aware of what open linked data actually meant, jumped into this game, and now are playing seriously on the funding of Horizon 2020 about big open data. And let's see what big educational data for our purpose is. It's data that is coming from online learning environments like learning management systems or educational e-learning environments, or learning platforms, learning software, which includes several bits of information like login, rates of participation in specific activities, time students spent when they interact with online resources, or time not spent because they are asleep on online resources, and well, how much they interact with other people in the class, and sometimes with information about grades, assessments. So analyzing these new logged events will require new technologies to work with unstructured information, unstructured tests, unstructured image data, and multiple resources. So this creates vast amounts of data. That's why we use the term big data. So big data are data sets. It's meant that the size of this big data is beyond the ability of typical software tools to capture, store, manage, and basically analyze to provide you with information. So let's just give you some examples. This is some example that tells you with different features when the test was done, when what is the best performance, what is the average in the class, in which topic, etc. You can combine different topics together, you can provide different demographics together, etc. Or, you know, simple information like how much you rate your own work depending on the best and worst performance in the class and the average class. Or in several topics or different ages or different groups or different tests, combining different people and different lessons together, as I mentioned. But why bother about this? Why do we bother about big educational data and facilitating the analysis and spending big amounts of money nowadays that our society in the crisis? Because the society in the crisis needs only three things, as people in the European Commission will say. They need education, better education than before. They need much better education than before. And they need much, much better education in general because they think it's important. So learning analytics comes to cover this gap. cover the gap of making the e-learning material more as an educational experience per se to the users. So we need, there is a need for better measurement, collection, and analysis and reporting of data about the learners. That's why we say, let's analyze the learning data, learning analytics. It's a very recent term. It's a term that relates with fields like educational data mining, academic analytics, which was a prior term that was dropped in, analysis that takes place in social networks, how many people are linked in Facebook and how many people are tweeting and retweeting several hashtags in Twitter, for example, or if there is an emotional content, or if there is a disease outbreak as it's outlined in social networks, and some business intelligence, what we can do to promote our own businesses. In this case, to promote our own educational business, to make our courses more attractive to students, more experiential for students. So we need to convert educational data into useful information and motivate actions. Motivate one's self-reflecting teaching and learning activities so that teaching and learning is improved. And I cannot really emphasize this much more. This is the emphasis of what learning analytics is all about. Make education and learning, the learning experience, better by using the statistics of learning systems. It's a completely new field, especially we coined the term medical learning analytics, which our team introduced a few months ago. We have tried together with Masaryk University here in Mechanic to apply for a grant in which medical learning analytics was a topic. There is also an article in preparation for this topic. It encompasses the leverage of learning analytics technologies to boost medical educational practices. How? It will establish best practices in obtaining student interaction quality, and it will optimize learning in medical sciences by fostering these activities to achieve clinical competencies. So this is a structure. We have different learning systems, different learning management systems on the right. These create a lot of data. Somehow these data about the data will need to be collected in big educational data structures. And these interact with what is called the linked open data clouds to get some information about the specific contents. And then you have all kinds of techniques. You have data mining techniques, you have reasoning techniques, you have theories like cognitive learning models and things like this. A lot of methods which will interact with these structures, and will also have interfaces, outputs, and also development interfaces to shape these tools and the queries that we do. So let's take an example from problem-based learning and virtual patients to accommodate this this drawing that I mentioned. This is a graphical representation of a tree of a virtual patient. As you might be aware, you construct these nodes with different trees, different branches. You can shape your branches as you want. The greens here are the correct and fastest way to resolve the case. Then the red ones are the no-goes. If a student goes into the red ones, we know he doesn't know what he's talking about. And therefore, ideally, we would like students to go through the green pieces of these tree and resolve the virtual patient case that there is in front of them. So basically, not every single student will do this. Some students will follow the ideal tree, some others will follow other trees, etc. At the moment, this information is lost in this learning system. There is no such information that will provide us useful insights on how well our problem-based learning or virtual patient was constructed. So this is what we are trying to do with this environment, which will use the medical learning analytics. We'll try to gather this information of interactions together so that we know what are the most frequent errors, what knowledge is missing so that students do these errors, and anything else that we can imagine. So we are trying to collect this from learning environments like the Open Labyrinth or the Linked Labyrinth as we have shaped in Educator, and then inform a teacher that was the creator of the VP of the virtual patient that there is something wrong with it, because a lot of students are doing this wrong in their own way. So in this example, the educator can go back into the case, reshape it, and therefore improve their own learning. Similarly, you can do this with different systems altogether. You can do it with a system that is Moodle-based. We call it Mars Plus because we have semantically extended that. We have learning activities here. I will emphasize this is called Paradata later on. And you have different theories that you can expect your students to interact. You have another learning environment there. And all this, as I said, you can combine it with knowledge that is missing, cognitive models, etc. From one side, you can inform the medical teachers, the medical educators to shape their courses. But on the other side, you can have statistical data that medical educational institutions, schools, or the ministry can be informed about, and therefore provide policies about curricula or decisions about medical education per se. Now, the technical prerequisite for this is metadata, and what we call paradata. Paradata are those metadata that refer to the interactions of the learners with the environments, with the resources. So in Medjugator, what we have done, as the video has explained, is that we are describing each of the resources with different such ideas, and we also link it with the linked open data cloud with definitions that exist there. And to do that, we have used a modernized version of the semantic web, the RDF, the Resource Description Framework, a framework to describe resources on the semantic web, basically. It uses the latest technologies of the semantic web to do that. So medical resource is actually linked with somebody that is creating that, and also is linked with a specific resource type. And we do relationships between these entities, basically, and with different resources altogether. So there's a tree, which is called the RDF tree of the model, that describes these data, these resources with different data that are now easily understood by machines, as it ought to be in the semantic web. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, just to mention that there are a number of classes. Some of them are obligatory, some are optional. And a lot of such classes are taking multiplicity and the union ranges from other resources, and multilinguality as well. But I mentioned earlier, as attention metadata, is data, metadata about the user modeling, basically, activity that the users are doing in the system with the learning resource. And here we have extended the Atom metadata schema that existed before to easily encapsulate this information in the resource and accommodate and accompany this resource in the learning system. And to do so, you can enrich, basically, this is all dynamic information that you can attach to your resource. And that is essentially the information about enriching this resource with dynamic features that is going to play a significant role in the next few years about capitalizing the big role of big data. So let us see how these concepts can be utilized in the virtual patients that I mentioned. I'll skip this because you all know what virtual patient is. The Open Labyrinth is one of the tools that we use. It's creating these labyrinths that I mentioned earlier on and explained how ideally our students would like to march through these trees. So what do? We want the model to allow easy use and reuse of media, questions, avatars, etc., as well as all this interactivity that I mentioned earlier on. So we have pathways, the nodes and the edges that form this graph that I showed, the network. The nodes are states of the patient incident. The edges are the decisions and the diagnosis of the learner and the decisions that the learner takes, basically. And the nodes can have many outgoing edges to different decisions, to different points that the student can choose. And pointing to different nodes will depend on the decision taken. So this is an example. This is a case that is described here. And these are now the edges. What do you do once you read this? You would like the student, the learner, to reply to your question. You take decision A, decision B, or decision C. These are linked basically to the other nodes or to the edges. And this forms the node, one of the green things that we have seen in the previous labyrinth. So basically, this is a rather complex labyrinth that one can create with links between nodes. And we are trying to find ways to make this graph more readable in a way. So we have abandoned these arrows that are classical, and we shape them with curved lines that allow us to sort of say which one of them is linked with which. And in this now, we are trying to fuse some information about the nodes themselves, So we want to annotate the labyrinths, discover labyrinths that are essential, that are related, for example, to geriatrics. Or you want to search for different algorithms in the system. Or you want to annotate the nodes or the edges so that once you have to do a new case, you don't have to start from scratch. You want to get from your own lab, from others' lab, from other labyrinths, those bits that are important for you. So, for example, you want to discover labyrinths where anaphylactic shock and opioids are referenced. And you want to see if there is anything like this in other algorithms, in other labyrinths, and take it as it is and put it in your own nose. And also inline annotation of content. Like you want to see whether there's a diagnosis about blunt injury, or whether there is a specific information about CT scanning, or other clinical information that you are looking for. So basically, you want also to include this static information, but you also want to include dynamic information, how much time is spent on each node, what is the most difficult pathway, as I mentioned earlier on. If the learning goals have achieved in this, so how do you manage all this information? If you, at the moment, you cannot store this information unless you extend your schemes of describing these labyrinths. And if you manage to do so, then you have big data already in your own labyrinths. So you want these data to be able to find, but also discover this information because you don't know exactly what you're looking for. And the result description framework that I mentioned improve this discovering by making the searches more readable to machines, basically, understood by machines, because they can understand now the links between the resources and the properties. So basically, we can create the new dynamic graph, basically, with all this information. The edge weights now represent the traverses from one source to the destination node. So if, for example, we are looking for something that has got a specific information, the output is going to show you that in a specific algorithm, a specific labyrinth, this is what you are looking for because it's the arrows are more thickened here. Or if you want to look where our students are doing the wrong thing, or whether they are doing the good thing, then the searches is going to retrieve you thickened arrows, and you are going to look into those branches of the algorithms of the labyrinths, basically, and utilize them appropriately. So basically, you can manage to see your own dynamically created now virtual labyrinths in this way with the VP data. You can have, for example, information about how many students have got answer A and how many students have got answer B when they tried this virtual patient. Is this an intended confusion, or is its choice somehow be resolved by using some textbook, and therefore go back into your algorithm and change it, change your labyrinth, and enrich it with information. And we can have even more insight with semantics like this. Students of class X have trouble deciding when decision involves the treatment of depression and other health-related issues together. So you need to, you know, be able to decide where this is represented in labyrinths and find that information, shape it as you want. And the long-term goal, of course, of this is to link these nodes with several large sources of big data, like electronic health records or applications in the mobiles that can give us a lot of data. And we try to populate the nodes and the counters and the choices that we have in the labyrinth with such information. But this is a very long-term goal that we're working on. So in the next few slides, let me show you also another similar to the MethaNet e-learning environment that we have followed. Basically, we have resources in separate environments, as I mentioned. These are RDFIs with the semantic web, and can be different environments like Mars Plus, which is a Moodle system, or Molina Plus, which is a Drupal system, as I say, or linked labyrinths. And these now linked together, information can be searched into all these instances. And Molina is a Drupal-based system. We call it Medical Education Linked Arena. It was based on these technologies as a Drupal instance. And it can allow you to explore, create a resource, describe them with the specific metadata, and also enrich them with information that you don't put in, but exists in the semantic web. So once you have a resource, upload it in the system and describe it with some specific metadata, then what is called a software called DBpedia Spotlight Annotation will retrieve semi-automatically resources from Wikipedia and attach them to your own resources. This is important because sometimes you want to enrich your courses with such information. It also allows advanced features of social collaboration, basically. Students and learners can do relationships with each other, be updated when somebody is updating their own resources, and this is forcing what is called social learning. We have also ideas of and implemented already how to do relationships between authors, but also relationships between the objects that they learn and the resources, and we're working on a research project towards this direction to represent these resources linked together in a map so that we know when my PowerPoint is traveling around the world, who is using it and how is utilized in the correct way. So the, some other advanced features which the MEFANET already has got is the quality processing control. So we have the first stage of publication, and after revision is acceptance and allowance to be uploaded in the proper portals. And also this repurposing that I mentioned, you can, once you find a specific resource, you can click a button and you don't have to enter the metadata again, but you can sort of be dragged into an interface where there are some of the data are put already there for you, and you can create your own object. This is free to use and free to install. You can even start a collaboration of bringing it into MEFANET and combining it with MEFANET or vice versa. Let me show you also an example of game-based activities in urology. We have a good collaboration with a group of urologists in Greece, which they form a group of extended group of urological education. There are about 200 urologists doing an annual training in urology, and we have created this training website for them. The Institute of the Study of Urological Diseases, they have a lot of brilliant ideas on how to shape all this e-learning content together. Let me focus on one of these activities, which is about gaming, urology quizzes basically. Here you see an exercise where it's a blended exercise basically. It's used two urologists, that you see here with the Greek names and profiles, have got two cases. Well, basically one case with two solutions. The first one is pretending that he is a follower of the first solution to resolve this case. The second one is a follower of the second solution. And they are trying to give evidence or provide arguments why their own choice is correct. And the audience here listens to them, and they have their own PCs or tablets, and then they can vote. They can vote as the time goes by, and at a certain point in time during the case descriptions. And basically these are like urologist wars, that you have the two knights here, that they are fighting to pretend which one is the best. And the data that are collected now is like a poll. The winner is the one that is going to get the best, the more votes. Now all this information is saved into the system. You can see at what point the users decide to vote which one. And this is valuable educational information. It means that it's the decision point for one specific urologist. It's a point where they are convinced that the evidence or the arguments that are provided by the others is correct. And this is what actually happens in the real life. At a certain point in the hospital, you think patient X has got disease Y. And this is what you follow then, you follow the therapy for that one. That information is lost nowadays in the learning systems. We would have liked it to be saved into what we call attention data, metadata, or paradata, and therefore provide us useful links and information about this. So some future-related work that will be done in a couple of minutes is about gaming, but utilizing the semantic web and the semantic Wikipedia, which is called DPpedia. So we have created games like the first medical semantic game, semantic medical game, which is called Doctor Who, where basically we have a drug that needs to be discovered or guessed by the players. And the players, all they have to do is reveal information about these, the symptoms, the type of the disease, or the type of the chemical compound, and things like this, until they realize what the actual drug behind this is. This is now an ongoing project with a couple of MSc students, one from the technical background of web sciences and another from the medical research methodology group, a medical doctor who wants to do this as an MSc project and put this with content on actual drugs, that are all this information that you see here is completely dynamically taken from the semantic web with clouds like the drug ID, the disease home, and things like this, and the DPPedia and Wikipedia per se. So this is a gaming experience for our students. We are going to use it in the next couple of years to train pharmacology. And finally, the semantic, virtual spaces, Second Life, that we are trying to make more experiential learning with the use of virtual environments like Second Life. But also not forget that our emphasis is not to provide just another experience, but still be able to keep these developments within immersive classic, immersive virtual environments like Second Life. So we are trying to put all these developments, the semantic, the social media, and things like this, also in the virtual spaces. So let me show you a video where you will see one of the virtual patient scenario that we have put within the Second Life. This is a project called the European project called Discover, where we need to train the carers of elderly people to, you know, obtain skills on how to treat or how to care for their own persons, or if they are formal carers, how to treat better the patients. You can see in the right hand side here the virtual patient case, the scenario here. So you can simulate the environment, you can click on objects, and then questions, specific questions are asked about this object, and you have to take decisions, etc., etc. So rather than just doing it in a PowerPoint or in a classical lecture or even in a VP environment, you immerse this subject and they take the form of the avatar. They are immersed into the virtual space, perhaps the place where the elderly will sleep, or the elderly will eat, or the elderly will sit, the house basically, and therefore be brought into the actual place where care is given, basically, and still linked with the problem-based capacities like the virtual patients scenario that you see in the right-hand side. Let us stop it because it doesn't make any more sense. So we believe that the last year when we finished the Medjucator project, was going to be a year of change. We are going to have impact on the Drupal communities, on the Moodle communities, semantic web communities, and different target groups, providers and users, expert instructors, students and learners, but also technical providers. And surely, slowly but surely, this is starting to be the case. But the big challenge behind big data and big educational data, as I said, is whether these technological artifacts we create will improve educational experience of the learners and the people that we have to educate. Will we be able to exploit this big educational data that forms a big part of the Horizon 2020? There are a number of projects that the European Commission expects from the medical community, some on the educational forefront, some of the overall medical big data. But what is the value behind this? Will we be able to exploit them? Well, the challenge is the learning impact, as I said. We have to have a learning impact. And we have to be able to measure that properly. Otherwise, we will not do any useful thing for our own system, for our own medical education. And I cannot emphasize this more. We have to measure it properly, and we haven't done it. We haven't done even studies in my group. We are scratching this on the surface now, but we haven't deepened it much. And this takes time. This needs a lot of time, but I assure you this is worth investing, and this is worth going for, to make sure that what we have technologically created makes a learning impact for our students. Thank you very much.